Viewers, welcome to C2C News. Straightforward, a Sunday evening show on Facebook Live. And we have with us our esteemed guest, Mr. Ramachandran Venkatesh from Chennai. He also has an office in Delhi, so he keeps shuffling between the two cities. Welcome to the show, sir.
Namaste.
Viewers, before we go ahead with the show, a brief introduction about our esteemed guest. Mr. Ramachandran Venkatesh is a PhD advocate, FCA, ACMA, student of economics, columnist, author of two well-known books, Decade of Decay and Sense, Sensex and Sentiments. And you must have seen him very often on primetime debates. And he is a well-known TV panelist. Welcome to the show, sir.
Yes, thank you. Pleasure is mine.
And viewers, I have a pleasant surprise for Mr. Venkatesh. He's very popularly known on social media as MRV. So I met him in 2013 during his book launch in Mumbai of Decade of Decay, and I took his autograph. Yes. And I never knew that one day I'll be on a live show with him.
Me too. I never expected this.
Great. Okay. We'll start with the show without wasting our time. The first question is, sir, you have so many professional degrees, and we often come across in our daily life with professionals like you who have a combination of degrees, which are like, you know, engineering and MBA, CA and MBA. We have also come across some MBBS and MBA professionals. You are a CA and a lawyer too. For the benefit of aspiring professionals, please tell us how it helps in the long run.
See, multidisciplinary approach always helps you to look at things from a far wider perspective. See, for instance, my understanding of economics, and I've been fortunate to have been guided by some very great people, including Mr. Gurumurthy, Mr. Dr. Swami. All these people have played a very important role in my career. So when I look back, I see that they never were unidimensional. So if you could go to them, for instance, I find it very amazing that whenever you go to a senior advocate, they say in Delhi, if it is a criminal law, you go to this gentleman. If it is a constitutional law, go to that gentleman. You know, in law, they are compartmentalized so much. But today, law is not law standalone. It is mixed with economics. It has got a political narrative to it or a background to it. You have to have facts. You have to marshal statistics. You have to understand statistics. So when you present a case holistically, you need to have this multidimensional picture in your mind, at least in your understanding. Whether you are able to communicate it, it's an entirely different thing. But at least your understanding, you require a multidimensional approach. In fact, I know one Mr. Sai Deepak in Supreme Court, who is an engineer and a lawyer. Now, very fascinating combination. Now, all these things, and there are some engineers who want to do law, whom I'm encouraging. Because as I see increasing automation of our daily life, we are going to have artificial intelligence, robotics, Internet of Things, all coming into play in the next 5-10 years. So you will have an interface of law and machines coming up in a big measure, to a good measure. So we need to prepare ourselves for the next generation of changes that are going to happen. So to that extent, I think a multidimensional approach to things helps. And that, I think my clients have also been profited. I hope so. I don't know whether my clients will agree to this proposition, but I believe that they have fairly profited with my bringing in rich, diverse set of issues on the table.
Right. Definitely, sir. This reminds me of one of my clients who is a MBBS, and he is MBA, and he is working at a DGMN1 pharma company. He's not a practicing doctor, but as a marketing person, like, he's doing wonders for his company.
Yes, so it always helps. A couple of, for instance, the cost accountancy course gives you great understanding of product costing and how you go about doing it. It's a very underrated course in India. But you do actuaries. Now I'm planning to do my actuaries. I'm thinking whether I should do it or not. So that gives another dimension to your whole perspective in life. So having done my PhD, I understood agriculture far better. So this is how we start understanding things. This is not for boasting or for anything. It is only for understanding that we know so little.
Correct. In fact, this reminds me of one small incident. You just mentioned actuaries. I happened to be for a meeting with one of the private insurance company. And as we were coming out of the meeting, one of the marketing person who was with me, he just pointed out to one actuary who was smoking close to the window. And he said, see, this person is a fresher and he's on a very higher package. And he'll take at least 10 minutes and this is the amount of money he's wasting. That's such an important process there. So, we are talking about a lot of reforms from the time Modi government was formed in the first term and now in there in the second term. A lot of things are already done, a lot still to be achieved. What, according to you, should be the two main focus point if we are talking about reforms?
See, I would put it at two different perspectives. On micro level, on program level, specific programs, they have been fairly successful. For instance, if Modi wanted to have Jan Dhan Yojana, it has been fairly well achieved. And that has been targeted, that has been brought down to the bank's level. From the bank, it has percolated to the 30 crore accounts, what they are talking about, Jan Dhan accounts opened and all those things. It's a phenomenal achievement in the sense you have brought a large section of the unbanked people into it. But what Modi is not able to do is get a fiscal headroom. To put it very bluntly, he looks to me like Jesus Christ on the cross and wants elbow room to expand his monetary or fiscal outlays, which he's not able to do. The reason for it is, there is, if you look into the, there is no balance sheet of the government of India, but if you look into the structure of the debt component of India, we are having something around, central government has crossed 100 lakh crores this March or April. Somewhere around that period, we have crossed 100 lakh crores. It's a huge amount. But provided you had a concomitant asset base of 100 lakh crores, yielding income, then there is no problem. But what is happening is, as per the government's own balance sheet or data that they give out, this liability is not represented by assets beyond 45 lakh crores. So 55 lakh crores of liabilities exist, but is not represented by asset. So there is no income. So all of us are paying taxes, all of us are paying duties, all of us are paying whatever to fund the interest to be paid on this 55 lakh crores. So the interest component of our budget is around 25%. It has come down to 23%. Okay, we can take it as 25. Now, if out of the budget of say that we are putting it at 7.5 lakh crores of interest, supposing this 55 lakh crores has a 8% interest, roughly 4 lakh crores. 8% will be 4 lakh crores. So if you save this 4 lakh crores, you have huge amount of money that you can do on infrastructure, on poverty alleviation, you can do whatever. But Modi is not able to get that 4 lakh crores of leverage. So he is trying like a man who doesn't know swimming. If he falls into the water, he will, you know, he will beat the water, but he will never be able to swim. So he is caught in a quicksand. So this is the first fundamental thing that he is not able to do. Fiscal elbow room, creating a fiscal elbow room, he is not able to do. The second or two subsidiary of this is, this can follow only through administrative and judicial reforms. Now, administrative reforms are very important. They are like your missile. You can have any program, any plan, any policy, everything spectacular, but you are giving it into the hand of a dud missile. You can load the best of atom bomb on a dud missile. The missile will not cross the border. It will blow up in your own border. If you require, so that is why Abdul Kalam is regarded as a great personality, because he developed the bomb, he also developed the missile. Because he had both of them. if you develop only the bomb, and believe me, Modi ji can give you 100 bombs in one day. He has so much of ideas. But his problem is he is not able to give a good missile. His bureaucracy is failing him. Judiciary is failing him. Till both of these are developed properly, till both of these are reformed, and we get, so for instance, I am in Chennai and I have to go up to Supreme Court to say fight a case. Let us assume, God forbid, I have to go. It is 2,500 kilometers away. Why don't we have 6 Supreme Courts across the country, benches? Why don't we have 6 benches of Madras High Court in various parts of Tamil Nadu? Tamil Nadu is a large state. Maharashtra has one in Aurangabad, one in Nagpur. Maharashtra, like state, must be 2 or 3 countries in Europe. It is a state in India. We should have 7 or 8 high court benches. But unfortunately, these are spoken of from 1970s, 60s. We are not getting into it. Administrative reforms, everybody talks about it. Nobody is going to come about and say administrative reform nahi hona chahiye. Everybody agrees. Everybody says that IAS has got a limitation in delivering. IAS has a problem in delivering. They are not masters. We have to get lateral entry. And what did this government do? They got 10 joint secretaries in the last 6 years. They should be, by this time, 50% should have been experts. And when you come to regulators, you get the same IAS Babu to sit in SEBI, say, sit in IRDA, sit in RBI. Same thing, you take the green ink and write on the left-hand side of the note in incomprehensible English. We want actual reforms to happen here. That's not happening. So we are stuck in 70s. Imagine in terms of delivery, the programs are still in the 70s. The mechanism is still in 70s. So that is our big problem.
Mm-hmm. So what is the way out?
See, way out is massive reforms. And when I say massive reforms, there can be 100 million ideas. You may foo-foo it. I may foo-foo it. For instance, I have been campaigning for the last 10 years that you are talking about new education policy. The only thing in the new education policy is saffronization or non-saffronization. Is it the most important thing in an education? What I mean is, education has got 100 different dimensions.
Correct.
Okay. And the opposition to it is also very petty. The debate on it is also very petty. Now, I would like all government officers who draw from the consolidated fund of the country or the state to send their children up to standard 10 to the government schools. Now, this, believe me, will transform education in this country massively. Why? You and I are sending, we will not send our children to the private government schools because we can afford private schools. Now, class A, class B, class C, wo alag baat hai, but we will be sending them to a private school. But when I go to a private school and drop my son, when I used to do it when he was a kid, I used to see Lal Batti Gadis coming and dropping their child in the same school. IAS officers, sales tax collector, excise collector, sabka jo gadi hai, income tax commissioner ka beta, sab usi school mein padhte the. Why? Because they did not want to send their children to government schools. Now, why don't you force them to go to government schools? Why don't you have, whether it is Kendriya Vidyalaya or state board government schools, you have it. And do it. And enforce it. And you know, then the private school may, there will be a huge seat vacuum. Then the prices will also fall in terms of your fees and other things. Nowadays, private school has become sort of a luxury. It is like owning a Mercedes Benz.
Correct.
So you see, there is an economics behind it. And also, education may, see, what is the problem in government schools? The girl child is not able to have a proper toilet. After, say, standard 4 or 5, she is not able to use the toilet. As fundamental as that. Now, if health secretary or education secretary ki beti wahan padhti hai, you see how it will automatically transform the quality of education. And believe me, no amount of budget is going to solve this. If you put 10 lakh crore... Sorry.
In fact, I had met one very senior officer long back. Mm. He was from this Navoday Vidyalaya. Mm. And he सर यू जस्ट गो ऑन गूगल एंड सर्च द काइंड ऑफ रिजल्ट्स वी आर क्रिएटिंग. जो अभी आपने मेंशन किया लाइक यू नो द हाइजीन फैसिलिटी एमिनिटीज व्हिच आर शुड बी देयर, दे हैव गॉट एवरीथिंग एंड इट्स सेइंग देयर इज अ ट्रैक रिकॉर्ड ऑफ नवोदय विद्यालय ऑफ यू नो सेंडिंग किड्स टू आईआईटीज.
Yes.
If this kind of education can be imparted in Navodaya Vidyalaya, why can't same model can be copied in cities and towns?
Because Kendri Vidyalaya, Navodaya Vidyalaya, at least there is some central government employees sending their children there. Yes. But if you send it that government schools are for thelawalas and auto rickshaw walas, you create a class in the society. Until my son sits with the thelawala's son,
very
okay. Private public schools will not improve in the quality, and we will be creating a class of people who will be semi-literate only. And this revolution requires no money. This requires like demonetization. Modi ji to come at 8 o'clock and say, "Bhaiyo aur behno, kal se sab IAS officers ke ladke ladkiya 10th standard tak government school jayenge." Period. And he announces at 8 p.m. and next day morning, everybody pulls their children out from the so-called DPS and the private schools, this convent and that convent, and pull them into government schools. The pricing of private schools will fall, which will make schooling affordable for middle class who are non-government employees. And for government employees, will go to government schools, and with along with poor, the entire education system will be settled. But nobody wants to touch it.
I think one reason which nobody wants to talk about it, irrespective of the political parties, a lot of politicians, they have invested heavily in education.
That's all. So nobody
wants to upset the apple cart.
In fact, in Tamil Nadu, there is a huge problem with NEET. Tamil Nadu is supposed to be a very forward state, a highly educated state, but when it comes to NEET, they were going on telling that this is disadvantageous for the school state board children, though they have performed spectacularly well. 57% or 60% have cleared in the latest NEET, which was held 15 days back. But the reason why local media takes up is many medical colleges are owned by politicians. Correct. Who are not getting their capitation fees, and who also own. In Tamil Nadu, we have a very peculiar situation. Only politician, you have to be a politician to own a channel. So every Tom, Dick and Harry has got a channel who is a politician. So, and he has got a medical college. So the entire media in Tamil Nadu starts barking day in day out that, oh, look, this is a great injustice done to the children of Tamil Nadu, and Tamil Nadu is being disadvantaged thanks to NEET. And so we have to fight out NEET. So we have to fight out Narendra Modi, and Narendra Modi has created this mess. So Narendra Modi is a big villain, and you start creating a Aryan Dravidian divide, upper caste, lower caste divide. You start creating Hindi Tamil divide. So you exploit the fault lines till the cows come home. But tell me, I can tell you with great amount of assurance, education is in the hands of a mafia in this country. Whether it is lower education or a higher education, this mafia has to be broken only when the demand comes down of the private sector. And the private sector has to be liberalized. We have to allow more schools to come in. We have to ensure that more children go to school, quality schools. And quality cannot be ensured simply by some board officials visiting once a year. We have to have better infrastructure and monitoring system, self-regulation, and one of them will be that send Babudam's children to government schools.
Correct. Fully agree, sir. Fully agree. We move on to the next question. Bihar elections are just around the corner. How much will SSR investigation play on voters' mind compared to the other serious issues they should be discussing or maybe expecting from BJP and any opposition party there?
Now we are on 18th of October, so
correct.
We are still some days away from the election, but the way it looks like, Bihar is a very complex and a very interesting state. Every Bihari who is above the age of 18 thinks he has a shot at the chief ministership. You know, he thinks he's a potential chief minister. It's a very politically, though we may be dismissive of that state as quote unquote backward, but I find that the state has one of the most Politically, if you look at it, it is one of the most knowledgeable states. People there are politically inclined, whether this side or that side, or having their third view, whatever. It's a very interesting state and also a very caste state. So both these things go together. Caste and politics go there together. So my view, according to me, Sushant Singh has a very limited appeal in the election. So if you think Sushant murder investigation, or if at all it's a murder, the investigation of it will influence Bihari election, I'm not one of those to believe. But to say that it doesn't have a role to play, because Biharis are intelligent, they will have a multiple issues, and one of the issues will be SSR death. One of them will be the migrant population, how it traveled back during lockdown from, say, Karnataka to Bihar. One of them will be the local law and order situation. One of them will be how the center is handling the state, with both Nitish's party and BJP being at the power, both at the center and the state. So there will be multiple issues. To say that one issue will be decisive, I don't think so. It will happen. But Sushant Singh will have a glamour quotient. It will not be, it will bring a glamour quotient into the entire exercise.
Right.
Yeah.
So, fake and biased news has become a menace.
Yeah.
Why news traders keep doing it without fear? Any solution that you think should be discussed by parliament?
I fully agree. It should be discussed by the parliament. But the way it is going, when a police commissioner in Mumbai comes about and peddles fake news about a particular channel, when the FIR is on a different channel. Now, I'm not saying that he did it on purpose, but when the FIR, when the reports, when the complainant, all have not named the channel, when the police took to this level, when police commissioner comes and gives a press conference and names a different channel, it disturbs the very idea of news and fake news. Be that as it may, My suggestion is that time has come for us to have a very, very robust mechanism, because tomorrow somebody can say Robin is Robin Hood, and get away. Because today you have multiple forums. You can have like what we are having in the YouTube or in the Facebook or Twitter or their own channels in YouTube. And multiple channels. I am told there are 800 to 1000 channels in India, television channels. So the proliferation of channels has become a huge problem to actually have a monitoring mechanism. So you can't actually monitor this conversation. You can say defamation laws and other things, but all these are failing because of the courts don't have the time to look into defamation and other things, because defamation again is a very extreme law, and it is practiced only in exceptional cases. It is not that daily you have a defamation case coming. So very few lawyers understand defamation and its nuances. So all these things, my view is that first thing, there is a need for self-restraint. Nothing will cross self-restraint as an idea. But since self-restraint is not practiced, parliament probably along with the Supreme Court, I'm using the word very advisedly, especially because there are several live cases in Supreme Court also, where perhaps lordships have to come together along with the parliament to devise a robust concurrent audit type of mechanism, wherein we actually look at the news and see whether a channel should do certain things and not do certain things. Nowadays, any type of language is okay in the channel. Any type of abuse is okay. Calling a opponent on the other side as rapist is okay. Calling the other, and that fellow also gleefully accepts and says you are a murderer. So it's a, you are listening to one side a rapist and other side a murderer, and the channel's anchor is caught between a murderer and a rapist. So all these things actually degrade the cultural quotient in a debate, and a debate is basically putting my point of view, and nobody puts his point of view eloquently. And today that has come to an end. People only abuse. People only practice the art of calling the others names and try to say you are as low as I am.
So people don't say I'm an elevated soul, I'm on a higher pedestal. All that I want to show is Robin is as bad as I am. So you are a rapist, I'm a murderer. So there is an equivalence amongst us. So let us go home happily and have our two pegs of whiskey and go to sleep. This is not the way it should be done. Debates are to elevate the viewers. Viewers are left with a poor taste in the mouth at the end of the day. So there has to be some sort of some sort of a robust mechanism, and I'm sure it will come. How long it will take, I don't know. This will not go on. This bitterness in the media, in the 9 o'clock debate, now it has started at 6 o'clock itself. From 6 onwards, you will find some channel or the other having some atrocity on the other panelists. That, I think, needs to stop, and we need to come into some sort of a proper civil pro forma in our debates. Having said that, I should also say that this is a reflection of our polity. There is a huge fractured polity in our country. The polity is that today you don't start looking at the opposition or the other side with some respect or you try to look at it as an opposition. You look at it as some sort of an adversary. So this adversarial way of looking at opponents must stop also. I think politics has come to a stage where we need to say opposition has to be respected, whether it is in the state level or in the central level. And I think we have to be more sagacious and matured. And we are capable of it. I am sure as a society, as a nation, we are eminently capable. But this is a crisis in our society that both politics and media are very acidic. And we need to remove the toxicity in our public discourse.
In fact, you know, long back I had written one article and sent a copy to the Honorable Home Minister also. After 1950 and then 1955, there was one amendment which was done in the Journalists Act that was only for the salaries, because there was only one media, the print media. From 55 till date, a lot has happened. Okay. Now, the government has to think about different verticals of media like social media, print, electronic, digital, whatever. And one common, aerial view of, you know, how everybody can be supervised, what are the, you know, limits one can go, and there they have to stop. Because that is what creating the problem. And most importantly, like everybody, like I'm one of those person who is running a news portal. But the government has to come out with a say, like, these would be the grades. So if you are a news portal with, or maybe a news channel, and having your entire staff who have not done a single basic course of journalism, then you will be, like we have in Bombay, we have got grades for the foods, the Shetty restaurant. Yeah. So you will be treated not on the BARC rating, you will be treated on the quality of person that you are keeping.
Yeah, we have to have some, and we are capable. We yes. are capable of this distinction and drawing lines. But best thing is there must be some self-restraint amongst people also. Okay, me included. I must say that, that should start with me also. I must confess very honestly. So we need to look at various dimensions and see that we are having a very healthy debate in our media. And sooner we do it, it is better for the democracy.
That's true, sir. Very true. Now we'll dig a bit in detail. Like, we touched SSR from Bihar election point of view. Now I like you to cover, because you have appeared on a lot of primetime debates, and as late as yesterday evening, a lot of water has gone down. So how do you see SSR case shaping up? Because there are different agencies. ED is there, then Narcotics Bureau is there, CBI is there, and now there have been talk that NIA should also get into it because of the drug angle.
Only thing we have not called is the army. military intelligence should also be called. So that should be the perfect one. See, I see this case as a very important telling moment in our public life. Now, to me, Sushant's murder is a context The larger one was the Disha's death. Death of Disha was perhaps more important. And death of Disha and Sushant, both of them in their early 30s or late 20s, you know, very healthy people, very robust, working, gregarious people, suddenly committing suicide is a sign of something very seriously wrong in the city of Mumbai. This is point number one. Now, even if they have committed suicide, let us assume that that is the version which is the correct one. I would start by questioning whether these two are linked first. And now 4 months has elapsed, four and a half months has gone by. We still are not sure whether both of them are linked or both are independent actions by two different people, but professionally they are linked. So this is a question which we don't have an answer. And for the first death, as far as Disha is concerned, till date we don't even have a proper postmortem that was, you know, in the public domain, we don't even know whether a postmortem was done and whether she died of jumping from a 14th floor of a building. And she had attended a party at 8:30. Now, it is eminently possible, theoretically at least, that you attend a party, you don't like the wine being served, you go home and commit suicide. That's possible. But if you look at people who have committed suicide, there is a psychological write-ups on that. Various investigation agencies have various telltale evidences, and if you look back how people have committed suicide, people don't commit suicide after going to a party, enjoying the day's work, going to some other place and then coming home and committing suicide. People generally brood, they withdraw over a period of time, they ask for help by various means. There could be people who have put it in Facebook post or Twitter, or they tell their friends, I'm done. Because I was investigating the suicide of Mr. Siddharth, the owner of CCD company, and I had gone through several of his personal correspondences and other things. So I could see with various people he was communicating. For last 1 year, there were telltale evidences he was crying for help. And that help was not coming because he was too subtle. But in retrospect, when you analyze those comments, it looks like he was crying for help. It may be that Disha would have told somebody that, look, I'm personally getting into a problem or a depression, or I'm facing this difficulty. And then one day she commits suicide. But nobody has come forward and said that this is what it is. Then her fiancé or boyfriend, whomsoever you call it, is missing. Her family members, nowhere to be traced. Nobody is making any statement. So Disha's death is enigma wrapped in a mystery, presented in a puzzle. You may call it whatever. You know, it is still a dark hole out there. So we don't know. Now coming to Sushant's death. Now you see, the man was changing his SIM card around 10-12 times in the 4-5 days leading to his unfortunate demise. Now, why should somebody suddenly change his SIM card so very fast? Why should he change it? Now, where did he all go? Perhaps we must plot all those things. Who entered the building on that fateful night on 13th or 14th? What did, and very strangely till date, the videography of his postmortem is not yet seen. And from what I understand from Dr. Swami's statement in Twitter, though I have not spoken to him, from what I understand is there are certain deficiencies in the manner in which postmortem was conducted by the Cooper's Hospital in Mumbai. So AIIMS has probably done a second postmortem, and what are the results? Are they significantly different from the postmortem done by Cooper's? And Cooper's, again, what is there in the public domain only, has not yet spelled out the timing of death. See, timing of death is a very crucial one. And with the viscera sample, they usually work back on a forensic basis. They work back and say, probably around 1:30 p.m. in the afternoon, Sushant committed suicide. So you start looking at who came to the house between say 12:30 and 2:30, and then try to say who actually with CCTV footage, with probably imprints on various other electronic media including cell phone tower, you try to figure out who probably came into that area, who probably entered the house, who probably entered the bedroom. So all these type of mapping is done only when you ascertain the time. Now, if the time is left blank, it is very difficult to look into it. The third dimension of these two things is there a political angle at play? Now, I am leaving around whispers aside. Now, why should Mumbai police not investigate the death of Disha Shalyan in any significant manner? Why should it be taken as some sort of suicide right from day one? Again, in one TV debate in a popular channel, one of the specialist, or I would say forensic expert, was having some pieces of evidence about Disha Salian's postmortem report. He says the postmortem report says she was brought naked to the hospital. Now, how can it be naked when somebody jumps from, 14th floor? Did she jump naked? So why did she jump naked? You know, these are all, of course, this may be slightly very disturbing to ask these questions in a channel, because probably children are also watching this show. So it may be very difficult to go beyond this, but I will stop here. But I ask this fundamental question. These are all very disturbing questions which the police has not asked. And then you look at how the police has acted on certain channels which have exposed this asked inconvenient questions post their exposure, and even prior to it, how they have actually acted. So, is there something, a larger political game being played in the state of Maharashtra? And these deaths are out to, are only a blip in the larger scheme of things. Are these deaths telling us some story? Then you take the drug angle. Now, when this is where we all know, and of course, I have no sympathies for NCB. Let us be very clear about it. I am not batting for NCB, but let me tell you, Bombay cinema industry, drug, celebrities, police, and politicians. This nexus, this mala, was well known to everybody. Every second standard student in any part of country would tell you that there is a nexus between all of these guys. Now, why did it not take the, why did NCB not look into it prior to Disha's death or SSR's death? I don't know. And why did the Mumbai police accept that there was no drug angle? How can it be that in Mumbai, any celebrity, any death, you have to definitely see, look into it, whether there was a drug angle, whether there was a flesh trade angle, and whether these two combined, and whether there was a third angle in terms of any mafia or any underworld working on this. So these are questions in any metro city should be asked, more so in Bombay. But Mumbai police, for all that intelligence that they claim, that they have the expertise, the knowledge, the cutting edge of technology that they have, literally became a stenographer. They said, oh, this is a suicide, and we have closed the case, and they finished it off. So in fact, my suspicion about these two deaths came not because of anything else. There were people, including certain channels and certain celebrities, including Dr. Swami, taking this, that this is a doubt, and this needs to be investigated. But my question, or my suspicion, arose from the conduct of the Mumbai police. Now, Mumbai police has a lot to answer. It is standing in the dock. And unless Mumbai police comes about and makes clean breast of what it did and what did not do, unfortunately, what is happening is this entire case has a huge political dimension. I don't wish to speculate about how this case is being used by various political parties. As you rightly asked the question whether this has got an impact on the Bihar elections, and whether, I wouldn't even know whether this will be talked about post-Bihar elections. So that also is a possibility which we can't rule out. In India, anything can happen and everything can come to a closure. But if we have to pursue this matter to a logical conclusion, I think we need to have all these reports, all the investigation laid down to the bare bone in the public domain, probably a charge sheet somewhere, or CBI, even if it is going to make a closure. I'm not saying somebody has murdered Sushant. I'm not jumping into that. I don't want Robin to be hanged because it satiates me, or I'm bloodthirsty. I'm not saying that somebody has to be hanged. No, not for any good reason. But there is a lack of faith. A faith has eroded on the system. This is a very serious one. The whole system works on faith. You can't be auditing every single system, every single death. If Mumbai police has been cavalier in its approach in so far as Sushant's death is concerned, it could be in several others. So we need to see that the faith on the system is restored. For that, I would suggest the Maharashtra government has to come forward, offer itself for a very detailed scrutiny, probably a commission of inquiry, probably a sitting judge of High Court, probably asking a sitting judge of a Supreme Court to look into this matter and say a time-bound result of 3 months. It says this is what has happened. Whether the Cooper Hospital did the post-mortem properly in both cases, whether the police did not allow contamination of the scene of crime, namely the bedrooms or whatever it was of Sushant Singh Rajput, where he is alleged to have committed suicide. How did Disha jump, and why did she jump? What was the reason behind it? If all these things are tabulated and brought into the public domain, no need. Let the probes go on. Let the CBI do its job. Let the NCB do its job. Let the other agencies, ED, do its job. But it is very important that the Maharashtra government ensures that the common man has restored his faith on the police and the other systems in Maharashtra. To me, today, Maharashtra is a banana republic. Anybody can get knocked off and nobody will get chat-cheated. This is the assessment I have sitting 1,500 kilometers away.
That's right. We move on to another question. During 2014 election campaign, BJP was talking about A to Z scam. Like, personally, I attended two different rallies of BJP in Mumbai. And in both the rallies, like A for Adarsh, B for Bofors, and it went on to Z. Why is it that even a big scam like Thorian scam is not being discussed now?
See, it is very easy to allege Robin is a scamster. It is very difficult to prove Robin is a scamster. It requires great amount of dedication, men, investigation, collection of painstakingly of evidences, marshalling various evidences and putting it across in a manner known to law, and actually taking it forward in a court of law. Now, what is happening? I would see it two ways. Now, there is a lack of will of the BJP to fight corruption. Personally, till date, now we have to quote somebody like Khushbu, who has recently joined BJP and from the Congress. So she says that, look, there is no charge of corruption on any of the BJP ministers, which is a fact. So that on that 100 out of 100. So this question, this paper passed with flying colors. But as you very rightly said, there is another paper called Tackling Corruption of the Past. On that, they may probably get 7 out of 100 or 5 out of 100. Total failure. Now, why is it? Now, if you recall the first cabinet meeting of the Narendra Modi government in 2014, probably it was in May 30th or 31st, they brought out one significant fact or passed a resolution that they will set out the special investigation team on black money under the supervision of the Supreme Court. Now, where is it? What it has done after 6 years? How much has it contributed? What has happened to the black money? In fact, this question very strangely must be asked by the Congress. The Congress is not asking this question. The BJP is not answering this question. And it is left to you and me to now ask this question and answer this question. Okay, so look at it. There is some sort of an alliance at a very, very macro level between all political parties. Let us not discuss corruption beyond a point. Corruption is only a transient one. Whether you are more corrupt than me or I am more corrupt than you. But on a whole, let us not talk about eradicating corruption. Let us not do anything on corruption. Because the symbols of corruption. Now, there was not only this other scam. Other scam people have come out. 2G scam people have come out. There was a railway scam. There was a scam. All these came in the last 3-4 years of Manmohan Singh government. But we find nobody being charge sheeted. No cases are being pursued. Jagan Mohan Reddy, Andhra Pradesh Chief Minister, had mind-boggling sums of money being alleged to have looted. Nothing has come out. He is happily there as a Chief Minister. Okay, there are. You look at the country where you find characters who have looted us allegedly for 50,000 crores, 60,000 crores. All of them are now honorable chief ministers, honorable ministers of this government or that government. So, and nobody talk, including the prime minister, doesn't feel compelled to talk about corruption. Now, especially past corruption. Robert Vadra. Now, Robert Vadra, who was the symbol of corruption for the BJP in the run-up to the 2014 Lok Sabha election, and before that in 2013 Rajasthan election also, they had campaigned very heavily against him, and they had used the word Rajasthan has become Robertstan, punning on Robert Vadra's name. But nothing has happened. Your viewers must know, the SIT which was formed by the this Modi government after coming to power does not even an office, does not have a steno, does not have a Gurkha, does not have anybody. You know, there is nobody there who is watchman, nothing. So, there is no office. So, both the lordships are still there and they are sitting in their respective houses. So, how do you expect to fight black money when the office is formed but the office is not actually allotted? So, there is a lack of seriousness in fighting corruption, especially the corruption of the immediate past. So, what is our fate? P. Chidambaram comes and pontificates on how to be honest in public life. We have Robert Vadra giving a discourse on how to be honest. So, this is our fate, that we have to take lectures from them, read articles from them on probity in public life. So, we have also taken Chalta Hai attitude, you know, general public also takes a Chalta Hai attitude. So, this is what it is. So, there is a lack of seriousness on the BJP for God knows what it is. Only a BJP top leader can probably explain why they are having a lackadaisical approach to corruption, which they themselves charge. It is not A for others, B for Bofors, Maine Nahi Bola. They have only told it. And it is the barest minimum I expect them is to come and tell us what they have actually achieved against these people in the last 6 years. My guess is the balance sheet is blank.
One more question which is linked to it. In 2014, these alphabets were spoken, A to Z. In 2019 came when personally Modi ji said that he has got the corrupts to the darwaze tak leke aaya hai. Abhi second term aane do, isko andar bhejenge.
Yeah, see, even now I am tempted to believe in Narendra Modi ji for a simple reason. I don't have an alternative, and I have to believe him because the alternatives are tried, tested, corrupted people.
Correct.
And I have no other choice, and I will. It is like Bata shoes, you know, Bata by choice. Bata by choice nahi hai, Bata the only choice hai. So, Narendra Modi the only choice hai. So, we will go by what he says, and let us hope in the next 2-3 years he has to do it. But what is discomforting is you cannot do it overnight. One. Two, several of those babus who were party to the loot. See, a minister in Manmohan Singh's government did not loot all by himself. He was party to the loot with several other players, including babus and other journalists, media personalities. All these was a cabal. That cabal more or less exists, though it has diminished in its influence. That cabal is free. Unless you are showing some definitive evidences that you are attacking them and taking action on them legally. And I, for one, I am not wanting an action which is not illegal. I wanted an action which is perfectly legal. And if they have committed a wrong, please go ahead, punish them, recover the money. And by this time also, you see, many people have died. evidences have gone, 6 years later, evidences are not there. Time has gone away. So you have forgotten events. So it is very difficult to actually tackle. And apart from Chidambaram, which is a byproduct of your INX media scam, which again came because Sheena Bora murder came to light. Sheena Bora murder came to light because of a very strange case, because the driver of Indrani Mukherjee was caught in an accident and he blurted out, and that is how this whole thing has come. Sheena Bora murder came back, and once Sheena Bora murder came in, INX media exploded, and that is how Chidambaram was caught. Chidambaram was not caught by a concerted action of corruption being followed by this government. So there are several cases, including the National Herald case, which are still in limbo. More than 6 years have elapsed, more than six and a half years have elapsed. Pace is at a very glacial pace. We are all, in fact, my interest has waned on this corruption issue to a very large extent, because I do not believe in this country politicians are serious to pursue cases of corruption against fellow politicians. That is my understanding of the system and the situation. Anybody who goes to Delhi will accommodate any corrupt fellow, even if he's an adversarial guy. There will be enormous amount of debates. There will be enormous amount of bile being thrown at each other in a TV debate. But when it comes to real action in the court of law, not even an FIR will be registered. In fact, barring Chidambaram, I do not see any case being registered against anybody. In fact, Manmohan Singh has escaped, okay, and not much has come about in the coal scam. Likewise, if you take your Ashok Chauhan has escaped in the other scam, 2G people have escaped. So, a whole range of it have people have been acquitted, or there has been no serious follow-up. Of course, the appeals are pending. Now, what will happen in a court, we do not know. How much seriousness with which it is being pursued, we do not know. And see, justice denied, delayed is justice denied. We need to give justice to the society. We can't be holding on for eternity. So my only answer to this question is, some BJP leader at the very highest level has to come and give an explanation as to what is happening, probably a sort of a white paper into what they have done to tackle the corruption of the previous regime. Because previous regime was voted off on a singular issue of malgovernance or corruption issue. If we do not do this, I think we are doing a great disservice. And as a corollary, as a corollary, there is one another point in this. We also talked about black money stashed abroad. We said 1.5 trillion is there, 1.6 trillion is there. We have not brought 1.6 billion, 1,000th of that money, we have not brought it into this country. Why? Because we have not prosecuted them even in our own country. Unless you hold Robin as a convict here and pursue your ill-gotten wealth outside, we will not get the money. That is the law. So, unless we seriously pursue this and we try to get those money from outside, we are not going to succeed. My view is that unless the government of the day clearly explains what is it that is holding it back, I wouldn't be surprised to say that this government has got some sort of a samjhota with a larger political agenda with the opposition.
That's the reason, very precisely. Like, you know, like some poor farmers on a small piece of land, they do a turnover of 110 crores.
There are many farmers. There are many such farmers in my state. So,
All across India, we'll find such farmers.
But the strange part of it is that they are also in politics. They are political farmers. Ordinary farmers don't have that yield. So, of hundreds of crores in a 10-acre plot or 12-acre plot. But if, once they join politics, they are able to generate. And there is one farmer in Himachal Pradesh whose apple orchard is giving some 40-50 lakhs per tree or something like that, we calculated. So, apples at 40-50 lakhs per tree is possible only when you become a politician. So, these type of cases are not pursued very seriously.
Right. In fact, you know, when I was asking you this question about 2019, so darwaze se andar leke aane ka jail tha, this was based on one tweet I had seen, in which Modi ji was interviewed by Network 18. I forgot whether it was a Hindi channel or the English channel before the election, and he said that I will personally ask Supreme Court, Honorable Supreme Court, to start case against all corrupt politicians, even if they are from BJP. So, if that was the intent, now it has to be executed. That's it. Chief Justice of India will not say no. He will never say no.
You will never say no. But the fact is, government should ask. Government should set up proper infrastructure, because trial will not happen at the Supreme Court level. Trial will happen at the trial court level, which is the Sessions Court. Right. So you require Sessions Court, you require proper assistance right from the Diwali to the court car to stenographers to judges, and proper atmosphere, and give them all the infrastructure required. See, for instance, you may know, on 1st November 2016, we had this Benami law coming in, and 8 days later the demonetization happened. Till date, can you tell me how much Benami assets have been confiscated by the government of India? 4 years, almost. By another 15 days, we would be completing 4 years. 4 years is a fairly long time to start confiscating assets. Can you tell me how many crores of rupees of assets have been confiscated? Tell me a number. I'm waiting. No.
Just small showers here and there to keep people busy.
Nothing. Not even that. Zero. After 4 years, which you tom-tommed as your very big reform process on fighting black money, Benami, all these things. As per an RTI filed with the finance ministry, the answer I get is that there is no Benami asset confiscated. Why? Because the courts don't have judges, the courts are not having proper infrastructure, people are able to get a stay, because Benami law, even the income tax officers, income tax department, which is supposed to administer, is doing it under pressure of Target. So you have so many people to be booked. So you go about booking people left, right, top, bottom, center without a responsibility, and courts come in and then they give a stay. So all these are happening. Finally, you are not having a missile to develop the. You have a good bomb. I am not saying that the Benami law is a bad law. It's a good law. But finally, missile kahan hai? Missile nahi hai. So finally, whether Modi ji says that I will do this or I will take the up to the gate, he can take it up to the gate. But inside the gate of the prison, somebody has to open and accept the prisoner. There is nobody there. That is his problem today. And many, including cabinet ministers, IAS officers, many of the regulators, many of the persons whom he has allowed to function, are proving to be a dud. That is the truth of the matter. There is very little delivery which is happening across several spectrums. Now, let us take, started a Skill India. Skill India has died. Nobody talks about Skill India today. Because why? Because he has not got a person who will take it with a missionary zeal. He started Smart City. I don't think so. Smart City, I have not seen one square inch of Smart City in any city in this country. Namami Gange, where they said they will clean Ganga within 3-4 years. I am still not seeing anywhere people in Ganga coming and telling that this has happened in a big manner. Coastal shipping. We know several of his pet projects that he talked about with great fanfare, great idea, and people supported it. There were entrepreneurs coming in, but got jettisoned because of a variety of reasons which nobody wants to look at it, because devil is always in the details. So it is not only corruption. I can say that you are corrupt, but if I have to prove that you are corrupt, it requires backbending exercise of ensuring I collect data, I take all these evidences, marshal it, put it in a nice cogent form, present it to the court. That he is not having people. So he is being failed by his own people who are not able to deliver to his ideas. That is what I see it at this point in time. Of course, whenever he has succeeded because of his own brilliance, or like Article 370 and other things that he has got about, it is because his ministers have delivered, like say the
spectacular increase in road laying, which is around 25-30 kilometers today. Nitin Gadkari has personally seen to that, that is being done. So all these where he or his ministers have got a particular talent, he has delivered spectacularly. But apart from that, if you take agriculture, in fact, one spokesperson of the BJP did not know who the agriculture minister was in the channel. So that is the state of affairs. You know, if you ask even the BJP people who is this agriculture minister, many people would not know. So this is where I think that there is lack of talent, which is expressing itself in a very big way in the BJP government.
I hope and pray things shape up.
Yes.
Because yeah, the expectation, and as you have rightly said, that the choices are not there. So people obviously will go to the best choice.
The only choice.
Right. Right, sir. We have a customary question at the end of the show. And that is like we ask our esteemed guest to share some message, anything they have in mind which they want to convey to the masses.
See, I am no saint or somebody who will give some message or somebody like a politician. I'm a humble middle class person and hard working person. That's all. I can take pride in my hard work. I would only suggest one thing. All of us, this COVID season, let us be positive. And I mean, when I say not COVID positive, positive in our mindset. So 2020 is going to be a very tough 2020. Next 6-8 months is going to be a very tough challenge for all of us, financially, emotionally, physically, health wise. All of us need to brave this out very successfully. Because especially I see, I have lost at least several of my friends in this last 6 months, known people, relatives. I also undergone mild depression because of that. Because when you see my own barber who was helping me with my for 30 years, is suddenly no more. And he has succumbed to COVID. Whom you know 30-35 years. And he was his shop was an amazing place where we used to discuss politics. Where on a Sunday morning when you go, you spend 2-3 hours there to understand so many people coming and talking about local politics. Right. And believe me, it was a very good barometer of local politics. And you could always see that the best of opinion polls will always fall short of what we discussed in the barbershop for 1-2 hours. So those type of things are what is telling me that the society is under a tremendous strain financially. His family is under a tremendous strain. Those who are in the small and medium business group are facing, those who are having 10 employees, 15 employees. They don't know whether to send them home or whether to pay them. How long can we pay them when the sales are not happening? So this moral dilemma is keeping and pushing us into a huge stress. So I only pray that remain positive. Things will definitely improve. This is the worst phase in our career, financially, economically, health-wise, and you may say socially also. This will pass and we will have a good time. And that good time is not going to be something which is far off. It may come very shortly. Probably Diwali may augur something better by Diwali time, months from now. I only pray and wish that we will all have much better time to come. And with this, I wish you all the best for the Navratri and Diwali season. Thank you very much.
Great. So, viewers, this brings us to the end. And next Sunday, we'll have Mr. Mukul Agarwal with us. He'll be speaking on Vedic arithmetic and new education policy. Thank you once again for being with us. And thanks a ton, sir.
Thank you.
For coming on the show.
Thank you. Right.